Hello everyone, we noticed that a large portion of you guys watch our videos without subscribing, so what's stopping you? Click here to stay updated with our latest nerdy content. And back to the video.
Assalamu alaikum, welcome to another Biostats video. In this one, we'll be discussing how we can quantify risk. Risk always comes off as a hostile term, but risk depends not only on the number behind it, but also the context. That's the definition of risk used in biostatistics. The probability of occurrence of an event. For example, a high risk to contract a terrible disease is bad. It's always important to consider the context. So now the question is, how can we know if risk is high or low? Well, we can quantify it. In this video, we'll mainly focus on odds ratio and relative risk. They're both very similar, but do have important differences. Think of them as two different people telling their own versions of the same story. They're both talking about the same thing, but in their own ways. Sort of like how a detective is gathering information from two witnesses, which would be describing the same event, but from different perspectives. Let's take a look at their formulas with our trusty 2x2 table from our video on how to evaluate a diagnostic test. We'll have to modify it a little bit though. We'll put exposure on this side and outcome on this side. Let's start with relative risk. Relative risk is a proportion. Its numerator is a probability of developing the disease in a population that is exposed to a certain experiment or have a particular risk factor. The denominator is a probability of developing the disease in a population that is not exposed to a certain experiment or do not have a particular risk factor. It's a lot easier to understand with an example. Suppose we have 200 smokers and 200 non-smokers. They'll go into the exposure row. Let's say after 10 years, 4 non-smokers developed lung cancer, which means 196 didn't. As for the smokers, let's say 40 smokers developed lung cancer, which means 160 didn't. Therefore, the probability of developing cancer if you're a smoker is roughly 40 over 200. So smokers with lung cancer over all smokers. Or 20% if we simplify. This will be our numerator. The probability of developing cancer if you're a non-smoker is roughly 4 over 200, or 2% if we simplify. This will be our denominator. Now if we put it all together, we'll get this equation. The probability of getting cancer if you're a smoker over the probability of getting cancer if you're a non-smoker. In other words, the probability of developing the disease if you're exposed to the risk factor divided by the probability of developing the disease if you're not exposed to the risk factor. And if we simplify it, we'll get 10 as our relative risk. So now, what does this 10 mean? Well, it means that if you were a non-smoker and decided to start smoking, you increased your risk of developing lung cancer by 10-fold, which really makes sense. You went from a 2% chance to a 20% chance, which is a 10-fold difference. On the other side of the spectrum, we have odds ratio, which is, well, a ratio. Its numerator represents all those with the disease broken up into those who are and are not exposed. The denominator is the exact same thing, but with those who are healthy. Let's use a similar example to explain it again, but we'll start off a little bit differently this time. Instead of having 200 non-smokers and 200 smokers, let's instead suppose we have 200 lung cancer patients and 200 healthy people. This is important, as you'll see in just a few minutes. Let's imagine 40 of the lung cancer patients reported that they smoke, and only 4 of the healthy persons reported that they smoke. Now the formula would look like this. You'd have 40 over 160 in the numerator and 4 over 196 in the denominator. This simplifies to roughly 12.25. So what does this 12.25 mean? Well, it means that patients with lung cancer are 12.25 times more likely to be smokers. Please be very careful and appreciate the difference. I did not say smoking will increase your risk of lung cancer by 12.25 fold. It's the other way around. Having lung cancer means you're 12.25 times more likely to be exposed to smoking. So why is this the case? Well, this is due to an important relationship between study designs and the two formulas we just discussed. Odds ratio requires splitting the population first based on whether or not they have the disease. Do you happen to know which study design follows a similar rule? That's right, it's case control. When it comes to relative risk, we usually use it when we initially split the population based on exposure and risk factors. And yes, you guessed it, it will be better suited with cohort studies. This is why odds ratio is used with case control studies and why relative risk is used with cohort studies. Furthermore, case control studies are usually preferred when the disease or outcome being studied is rare, when the disease or outcome has a long induction and latent period, or when exposure data is difficult or possibly even expensive to obtain. To summarize, let's run our example again. A represents smokers with lung cancer, and B represents smokers without lung cancer. C represents non-smokers with lung cancer, and D represents non-smokers without lung cancer. Your relative risk is going to be A over A plus B divided by C over C plus D, while your odds ratio is going to simply be A over C divided by B over D. That's it for this part. We hope you are two times as likely to understand relative risk and odds ratio. And as always, don't forget to like and subscribe to receive our latest explanations.